Welcome back. We're here again. Game number two between Rave and MVP is kicking off. The draft has begun. They're speeding through it incredibly quickly as we get ourselves into the picks and bans. And game number one, if that was anything to go by, this is going to be an absolute slaughter fest. Everyone killing everyone. Smoke ganks at 3 minutes, 4 minutes, 5 minutes, whenever smoke's off cooldown and back in the shop. And it looked like everyone was just out for blood and vengeance. But in the end, MVP, they came out on top in game number one. I mean, it looked pretty decent for them with the Kuro Spectre, but what do you think Rave have in store for us now, Mottpax? Because it's a different draft completely.
Yeah, I like the fact that they've gone for the Bounty Hunter, and they're going to answer back with the PL, obviously, just because it is one of the more survivable mids. It's something that they love throwing out here, just in general from the SEA region. We got to see it last night coming from Complexity, and it destroyed. Even though there was an Earth Spirit, there was just no way they could kill him. So mid lane, safe lane, wherever you want to throw them. I prefer the mid lane, honestly, at this point. Just the way you can spam out the lances anyway. It's not like OD really relies on bottles or anything like that, so all good by me. But Invoker and Bounty Hunter, I believe, were the two biggest heroes of MVP Phoenix at the major, so that's kind of comical, right?
Yeah, it's been swapped up.
They shouldn't have had to deal with them.
Yeah, it's kind of interesting. Lion as well, you know, Dubu Lion and Witch Doctor, Fevi, Bounty Hunter, and Chantress were kind of the big picks, and those QO or MP Invoker were like their three or four mainstay heroes. Well, MVP, I mean, they've got QO OD now and an MP Phantom Lancer. Uh-huh. Femi Tusk is pretty sick as well. Interesting, though, that Rave don't ban out any of Dubu's other heroes. Witch Doctor is probably going to be the one that they aim towards and look for now. But Forev, what's he got left for the offlane? Darkseer, Batrider, Enchantress, Lone Druid all taken away reserve from him. Tidehunter's still out there. I mean, what do you feel about Tide in this lineup?
I think the one that I like to compare everything kind of to would be like the Faceless Void Sentinel, because I always find him to be safe to be thrown in the offlane because it's pretty hard to bring him down, hard to kill. And the difference between like a Tide and a Faceless Void in this sense would just be that the Ravage is a lot easier to get off against both Lion. He's easier to get off against the Invoker, assuming that you're not going to get EMP'd. But I mean, it's same with the Faceless Void. If he gets EMP'd, it's just like game over anyway. So I kind of like it. Not like the PL has the best synergy with the Faceless Void. At least Sven can focus the other parts of the team fight with like the stun, helping to hold them in place and get some stuff done. But with a Tusk as well, I think the Tidehunter makes more sense than the Faceless Void would. The only problem kind of comes in the late game where you don't have that lovely 60 seconds of the Chronosphere. But Tide suddenly looks a little, you know, even like you know, a little bit better maybe.
Look at that Broodmother, yeah. That's a nasty little hero, and it's going to be difficult when you kind of know that Febby does like to roam around a hell of a lot on his Tusk. It leaves a deficit in one of your lanes. He's going to be having, you know, Dubu and MP kind of the pairing in the safe lane. Broodmother can definitely exploit that a fair amount. But MVP, where are you heading now? What are you going to aim for? I've got PL, who's a, you know, slippery little devil. He's kind of mobile in team fights. He can join these little skirmishes early on with his lancers and his doppelganger. OD, not the biggest team fight hero, but with an Ogre Magi. That's bizarre to me.
Well, we saw it a bit at the start when OD was first starting to get picked. Teams were bringing out the Ogre Magi because they were looking for the Bloodlust on top of the OD, because everyone was just trying with everything they could think of to increase the attack speed. Speaking of which, there is still a Beastmaster in the pool.
Oh.
If this was OG, I'd be like throwing that in like the safe lane for Team Rave. That'd be kind of sick, but it looks like he might just slip his whole way through this draft. But either way, I like it. Bloodlusted OD. And no surprise on the Tide ban.
No surprises there. MVP, what are they looking to ban out? So there's mid, off lane, there's the two supports out for Rave, so it's the one role hero here. I kind of look towards Gyro, of course, still the safe bet. But Sven. Cleaving Sven is going to be taken out. What do we look towards? Gyrocopter's there. Ember Spirit was banned out, of course, by MVP since they picked up the Phantom Lancer. There's still heroes like the Anti-Mage, the Juggernaut, other heroes that buy Battle Fury and get cleaved through that. But we can't forget about heroes like the PA, right? This was one of JO's heroes back in the day. The Phantom Assassin against an OD against the Phantom Lancer, that natural evasion from your skill set, is pretty damn good. I'm just wondering how good it is, though, against the Tusker and Ogre, seeing as they're, you know, pretty tanky, good armor, not the easiest heroes to just jump on and kill off. They're very robust supports. But if you pick up a PA here, you've got lockdown and control to keep her going through the team fights. And I think she's good, or decently good, matching up against the cores here of MVP.
Yeah, you definitely feel like you need something mobile to help deal with the ice shards. Like, it used to be with CPL all the time up against the Tusk when he was really popular. So, I don't know. If it was another team, I'd almost favor something like a Tiny. But let's say they will just go back for the Gyro, the safe mainstay. And someone who can hit both that, you know, like early to early mid-game timing if the Broodmother has a good time, but can also, you know, if Brood has to get a little bit of recovery farm, Gyro can also help with a little bit of like four-man push at the same time, coming up with the Bounty Hunter and the Lion and the Invoker. Now, left for MVP Phoenix, it'll just be that offlaner. I don't know, do you commit super heavy to like the anti-Brood? Do you go towards the Axe? You know, something along those lines, something a little bit wonky, a little bit crazy.
I'm not even sure. Like, it's a difficult one, because going aggro or trying to set up your lane so you have like a 1v1 against the Broodmother, that what does that leave you? Tusk, Ogre, plus a Phantom Lancer in like an aggro lane. You could have the PL mid for QO and have like MP safe lane OD or like an aggro lane OD. And it's something we have seen in the past, where if you're forced into a situation where you can have OD in a 1v1 regardless of what lane he's in, he can still do decently. We've seen offlane ODs before, just because they had to move their lanes around. So that's still an option here. Against the Gyro, I'm not too sure how well it's going to work out. A Gyro Lion in particular. Having like an Ogre plus an OD in a lane together, trying to brawl it out against those guys. PL mid, then and like a Tusk moving between lanes, controlling runes, and then you do have the kind of 1v1 between, like you said, the Axe and the Broodmother, and that's exactly what it's going to be. And it's the the big red bearded devil.
I like it. I always love seeing Axe. This is the second one I've got to cast in the past little while. Obviously, both times. Up against the Broodmother. Not too much of a surprise. Really, the only time you get to see him come out. But he's so much fun. Slam, jam, dunks. You know, he's got the early Iron Talon, so he's looking to deal with these spiders in the easiest way possible, I guess.
Oh, he rushed Iron Talon.
That's weird. No Stout Shield.
No Stout Shield. Interesting. Huh.
The hell?
Oh, the way they're saying...
Are they not going to match him up?
Oh, these guys. Of course, you know, they met each other in Korea when Rave used to live there. Oh, the banter between them. Lovely lads. Well, Ninja Boogie already out here with his Observer Ward very early on towards this ancient stack in place, just in case Axe wants to start building things up for himself, but also giving good vision across for rune control as well. Ninja Boogie, though, has he been scouted out? Oh, I think he has. That Radiant Obs Ward up on the cliff here gave vision of the Bounty Hunter. I know he was wandering around in that area, but I don't think they're going to be able to catch him out too much. Well, Rappy Broodmother down at bottom lane, one sentry, as well as some tangos. 500 gold in the bank, though. Kind of interesting he's not spent up. Not bought, you know, a Sol Ring recipe, no Sage's Mask, no Salve or Clarities or anything like that. Just keeping his money secret and safe. Let's see what he can do with it. As Forever's being slowed out and body blocked by Ninja Boogie, the stun from Derp comes through, but it's the Ignite from Dubu, as well as the damage from the Lance. QO may be able to get a kill here onto this line, and it looks like they'll secure it with the Ice Shard through from Febby, and another Lance from QO. Who do they give the kill to? It's QO. Give it to him. Give him the gold. A little bit of a dance there between them all. You know, the Lion just standing his ground, accepting his fate. Wants to die quickly so he can return back to the map and get to lane. But how are they setting up here? So, 4 Axe up at top lane. He's going to be in this lane up against the Gyrocopter Lion. That's not really what we were expecting, but Ninja Boogie Bounty Hunter already going to have to deal with these sentry walls towards mid. And it's definitely an interesting game for these Invis heroes, right? Because there's two sneaky little bastards over on Rave. Brood plus Bounty. So you can kind of guess that the supports are going to have reveal at every point in the game. But it also means that your expenditure on sentries is going to be that much higher.
MP actually bought Dust, and he popped it at the room just to make sure that... Rappy wasn't going to be there to grab it, so didn't end up being a concern he wasn't there, but, you know, nice to have that on hand. And, yeah, this is so weird. Like, we draft the Axe, and then it was like, we're going to send him top lane with an Iron Talon. Like, they knew they weren't going to match him up, clearly, if he didn't start with a Stout Shield. This is rather unusual.
Oh, well. Farab's going to drag the wave back. And he pulled across into that large camp, but look at Dubu. There's no sentry far up. He's actually placed it down into these trees relatively deep. He's controlling this area, just wandering back and forth between the edge, between these two webs. Well, Ninja Boogie mid, they've actually dewarded the sentry. Febby and QO have made up this dual lane now, but it's only to get rid of the sentry that Ninja Boogie had, so there's no more reveal towards the middle lane for the Dire. And MVP are going to know the movements that bounty hunter make every single time. And it's something that you do have to worry about as a bounty hunter. Do you try and gank mid over and over again? Are you going to try and expend your time trying to get that one good movement onto QO? And it looks like they've started off a good amount of damage back onto the PL, but Febby's here. The cold snap's not going to do too much. The snowball forward and ice shards out. Febby and QO are actually looking for a kill onto Ninja Boogie. And with a lance forward, it's going to be a secondary kill for them as well.
Wow. Man, this sentry just paying off big time over here. Like, you lose so much of your threat as a bounty hunter if they know where you are. I mean, obviously, but it's just the fact that he's not threatening the courier, he's not threatening any of the other lanes, so there's no real fear for Ferev, rather. He can just jungle away over here. This is still, like, boggling my mind right now. It just seems so odd. Like, why did you even pick the axe? I just don't know.
I'm not sure. Like, maybe once he has Iron Talon.
Oh, Rior, they're diving him.
Oh, they got him. Verify's not enough. You're right. Straight in behind that tier one. Another kill for MVP. This time clearing up the mid invoker. Great play out from MVP. The illusion rune there. The QO paying off dividends already.
But yeah, I'm just going in. Like, he just skilled Doppelganger. He didn't even have it for that.
I'm just wondering if this. Oh, he's going to get slowed out here. And the damage output. Rior, Sunstrike, Cold Snap, Doppelganger's there to dodge it out. No damage really onto this QOPL. He's running away with this lane. Last hit's not amazing, but that's not what you do with the Phantom Lance mid. It's all about the Phantom Rush forward, the Lance spam out, just pissing off your opponent and trading farm as much as you can. I'm just wondering about the 4 of Axe. You know, you're asking the question, but is it more to do with, like, when he gets his. Like, does he rush Blink? Does he go Vanguard and then trade lanes and go and deal with the Broodmother later on? It's not as though the OD is a gyro. You know, it's not as though the OD can go and do stuff relatively early. He does need a build-up time. He does need these items initially to get him up and running.
Yeah, I think it'll be the Blink Dagger. And his play is, like, obviously it's still a good counter to the Brood because you just blink on top of her and her spiders and the jungler or something and get the kills. MP just going to run down right now. Boogie coming in. Will they commit to this? And the spider's still going to tower? I kind of like to, honestly.
Oh, MP. Looks like he's okay.
He's just Ninja Boogie not committing.
Clear through these little spiderlings, though. It's so annoying. This does force does force MP back to base. The Sunstrike.
Oh,
got him! Barely! What? Really? That was, like, on the very edge. Perfect placement. From that invoker, just scratching. OD and getting a kill as well. So they get themselves up on the board, 3-1. Gyrocopter is finally getting some farm up on this top lane. You know, JO didn't have a great game one. He got no farm, got shut down in lane. This time around, he's going to be able to snowball a little bit from this laning phase and maybe start pushing into these tier ones a little bit earlier. As Forev, he tries to drag the wave back with a Battle Hunger. Oh, get it. A little bit closer to himself as well. Just an awkward laning stage for him. But yeah, but back to the question. Like, does he go Tranquils into Blink? Does he go for the Vanguard? Is his role going to be to swap out lanes and go and 1v1 the Broodmother once it hits, like, 10 minutes?
I think I like just the Blink first, honestly. I mean, I wouldn't mind seeing a Stoke Shield, but I think the Blink would be a solid choice. And he really is their big initiator. They don't have much else. Once again, it's the same idea of just, like, you have a Tusk, but you don't have that AoE kind of initiator who can grab just more than one single person or, you know, even a little bit of a pullback, right? It's like a mini lasso. You can drag them all back into everybody. And then he can go deal with the Raffi after,
Doo-boo.
Speaking of which.
Doo-boo. Die in a bottom lane, Sunstrike, not good. Cool. Oh, well, almost landed again on the Dooboo. Not quite, though. With the Astral down to Rappi, they're going to catch him up. He gets the kill on the Ogre, but it's going to be the trade-off of his own life. So they've still got that Sentry Ward barely, giving a remnant of vision here for MVP, but it's just the damage that this Brood is doing. One death by 6 minutes is perfectly acceptable for you as a Broodmother, especially when you're, you know, taking OD down to half his life, getting kills for your Invoker, taking out the Ogre. You're just doing so much annoyance on this lane that you're going to start forcing people to TP down to try and react and deal with you. And this is where I kind of feel that they swap lanes. They put Axe bottom lane and they just let the OD Ogre go top.
Yeah, that's true. It does become one of your options, and Derpy's trying to apply some more pressure here with some cheeky tangoing.
Radiant's top tower. Are you just trying to leech experience, or does he want to go for a kill? Salve,
I feel like
MP.
Once the Brood comes, maybe.
See where they go for it. QO. What have we got so far? Poor Man Shield, Magic Wand, all these small incremental stat items, but it's up at top lane. Arcane Rune for Ninja Boogie, looking for the Axe. Borev's on full health though. Not the easiest kill by any means. I don't know what Ninja Boogie's planning on doing up here. Because MVP, they're not going to be throwing any of these squishy heroes up to the top lane. Right now, it's just trying to balance out your farm and make sure you don't die.
Yeah, it seems like a little bit of a waste of time. Maybe if you can spot out the Tranquil Boots, honestly. Oh, that would be rather hilarious. I assume he won't drop them though, right?
No. Not against the Bounty Hunter. Like, you've got no idea where he is. If he popped himself up on another lane, then, you know, maybe. But at this point, you're full HP. It's not really worth dropping your Tranquil Boots for this. Just keep them on you. Don't want to give anything to this Ninja Boogie Bounty Hunter, who's currently sitting 0-1-0. No boots just yet for him, and it's super rough. You know, level 3 bounty by 7 minutes. Oh, Ogre dies at bottom lane to the Broodmother. Spiderling's going at it again. I don't know. How does Bounty get his level 6 from this? What does the Bounty do to start winning this? Like, he's meant to win the lanes.
Well, what does he do this game, really? Kind of the issue at this point. No courier snipe. Couldn't get that early pressure mid, dying to QO in the combination of the Tusk.
Well, they're going to kill MP at bottom lane. Spiderlings are there. Hex is out, and the stun. Gonna take him out. Nice. 4 out of TP in. Does get caught by the Impale as well, so they've kind of swapped their lanes, and I think this is where they're gonna stick them. You know, keep 4 out down here. But now the question is, do they move Rappy up the top? Oh, Breezy. Gyro. He's coming in.
Oh man, Rappy's playing this so well.
They've got the cooldown. He's just baiting it out. The Spiderlings come back in, they kill him off. Axe is gone, and the tier 1 tower gonna fall shortly after as well. And you take a look at the Broodmother. Midas has been picked up. That's his primary item.
Hold the Brood. Midas Dagon, let's go. I like the way that he was just sending in like 3 or 4 spiders at a time. Just slowly wearing down the axe, because like that stem shield, yes, but you know, he's not up to that vanguard or anything.
Ninja Boogie up top. They've got the sentries, they've got the snowball as well, so the stuns and damage are there. We'll stop him from TPing out back to safety. This is where Rave starts to take control of Radiant Jungle though. They've got full vision over towards this area as well, as that tier 1 has dropped. The Broodmother just, you know, starts planting her webs and keeping the spiderlings going. While they're smoking up towards mid, MP is actually sitting on the middle lane now, while Phantom Lancer is up to top pushing away. There's a smoke from Rave from the east, while Invoker, he's got his 9-minute Midas, not an awful timing. Pretty reasonable, seeing as the pretty tragic lane he was sitting himself in. He's got his double forge as well yet. Not quite. One more point in Quast and I'll have it.
Oh,
waiting and biding the time. They know. MP stunned up. Sunstrike's there. Simple kill. Astral. We'll keep him alive for now, but there's nothing really stopping them from committing except for the ice shards. Turn around for MP. The forge sprint. Oh, it's not going to kill him off, actually. And QO comes in for the turnaround. I thought that would be a simple takedown, but it's actually Rio that's the one in trouble with the snowball forward. They've got the stun and another bit of damage out from a lance from Rio, or from QO even. We'll finish him up. We'll derp the lion.
I mean, that's what happened, right? I was just thinking, like, yep, he's dead, but there was no man left for the finger. And it was just a simple escape.
Am I going to catch him? Doesn't look like it. Sigil, he's turned around to hit it. But Derp, he's not in any imminent danger right now. As Forever is trying to cut these waves and clear them out. Broodmother's not the easiest guy to deal with at this point. She's already a couple of levels. Oh, no, she's not. I thought she was a couple of levels up with all the kills she's got. 4-1-1. But Forev's actually sitting at level 9 himself. Huh. I guess...
Yeah, that is a little surprising.
I guess Rappy spent the first couple of minutes very passive, sitting back, not really doing too much, while Forever's always had experience to leech, and has been playing very forward for the entirety of the game. But I don't know...
There were a couple of rotations as well. Like, the bounty was kind of bought for a bit, and the lion as well, so maybe soaking a bit off of him.
Well, Phantom Lancer, 5,500 net worth. Boots of Travel are up, so QO does have the opportunity to move himself around this map a little more freely. And dodge out from these ganks coming in from Lion and Bounty Hunter if he wants to with a doppelganger, but it's bottom lane. You can't dodge out of this one. 4F stun, finger, dead. Even with a Berserker's Call, you're not going to save him from all that magical damage, and it's a dominating Broodmother on this bottom lane with a full army of Spiderlings still. And it is difficult. You want your axe to be in a 1v1 vacuum against the Brood just to try and deal with this. But it's being played so well by Rave. They move in. Is he in trouble again? He's in more than trouble. He's in death. They astraled up the Forge Spirit, but I didn't even need the damage from it. QO will come in, clear him up, take out this creep wave. And they've actually done a lot of damage to this map. 2 tier 1s are down. MVP getting a lot of gold in the bank from this. Well, Rave, you know, Rave look good on the bottom lane. They're applying pressure, they're forcing rotations, they're doing a hell of a lot of work down there, but it's the top 2/3 of the map. that MVP are really calling their own.
Yeah, it's... I guess maybe it'll come down to what they can do against the Brood, but I kind of like the fact that they're just ignoring it for now. That is one of the better parts about the Axe, right? Like, even though it didn't go that well, you can still shove him down here. Yeah, maybe he will die, but I don't think the Brood can do it on her own. He should just be able to TP away if the kind of a threat does come in. He picks one up, but you'll need the rotation of the line. You'll need the rotation of the Bounty Hunter, and as long as someone else is down there along with the Brood, it should just allow them to push in with this other four because they are extremely strong. Looking at this OD, look at that Bloodlust. Swinging away.
I'm so glad that Dubu is going for the Bloodlust, because who were they playing against in the Shanghai Major where they had Juggernaut Ogre? Was it Liquid? I think it was Liquid. Where MVP picked like Juggernaut Ogre Roaming Duo or something like that. And Dubu didn't go for Bloodlust, and they had a hero on their team. Yeah, they had a lone Druid on their team that they really should have been giving Bloodlust. Ninja Boogie dies up at top, not a massive surprise. But yeah, just having this extra attack speed, movement speed for both QO and MP, it makes a massive deal, especially when you're shoving into these towers, because they don't have a natural pushing lineup. They don't have anyone that can really do massive structural damage. They need every little inch they can get. Well, down a bottom lane, the hunt is on. Forev, 600 gold away from his blink, but he's not going to be giving it that easily. As Rave, they're on the hunt looking for him. Just waiting for that moment to strike and snipe him out. And with this observer up on the high ground, Derp is going to move himself in. And Forev, he thinks he's safe, but he's definitely not. Sunstrike cooldown. And that was so smooth from Rave.
Is this even worth it, though? Like, I feel like this tower is just dead anyway. Do you really need this massive rotation? And you get the kill on the Axe, but you're forfeiting a tower that I feel like you could have defended as Rave.
I'm not sure if they feel comfortable fighting. Like, fighting into an... I guess OD was pretty low on the HP, and they saw that one when he was retreating out, but... I don't know, fighting into... PL plus the Tusk and the Ogre, they're tanky, they're annoying, they've got these disables, a little bit of an escape mechanism from your Phantom Lancer, it's just awkward as all hell. Well, Broodmother, hello. 14 minute Orchid after the Midas? This is where things start to ramp out of control.
Yeah, kind of an interesting Orchid game. I guess the most obvious one being for that PL, but you just gotta assume QO, I suppose he hasn't seen it, right? So he's going still into the Defusal Blade. Might have been a good chance to honestly just grab up a Manta. I don't know if you need the Defusal Blade that badly. If he knew about the Orchid, he'll soon find out about it, I think. And Febby might be the bearer of bad news. Well, I guess depends. Looks like he's got enough friends that the spiders won't be able to do anything.
You can purge off the silence. It's going to waste a charge and all of that. But it's still a good aggressive item. Up against Gyro, you know, he relies heavily on his mana to spam out cooldown and rocket barrage, things like that. Lion and Bounty Hunter, easy to take down with that physical damage on top of it all. Well, Rave, yeah, you're not going to be seeing BKBs anytime soon. JO's Gyro still needs a lot of build-up time to get into the SNY. He's 5,600 net worth, and it's not bad. It's just that your one-role hero right now, the guy with the majority of the farm on the field here, it's the Broodmother. It's not your active hero. It's not the hero that goes around looking for fights. It's more the hero that sits on lane and waits for people to come to her. Well, MVP, they are the ones roaming around looking for fights. Just grouping up as five and pushing into tier ones.
This is definitely the best answer to the Brood, right? Looks like they're actually drawing her to come over to top. Looks like they kind of want to bring her into the fights, maybe. And get her active in the pushes. It makes sense, right? If you're building an Orchid, then you definitely want to be involved in these engagements. But the group man, the five-man group up, you know, this is what you do against the Broodmother. It doesn't allow her to get anything extra out of some easy pickoffs. So MVP, this should be two quick towers. And again, can they even rotate here?
It looks like Rave are going to content themselves with just pushing top lane. I mean, they've taken the tier 1, they've got Spidlings and Forge Spirits, there's lots of little minions and summons and stuff like that to push into these towers. But it's just going to be that little bit slower than MVP. Well, oh, here we come. TP's come through. The tier 2 down the bottom lane is going to drop, while the tier 2 up top is fortified through.
Smoke on Dubu and MP.
And Rave, they might get caught here. The Silence, the Orchid onto Forev with a Meatball, Sunstrike that killed off the Axe, but in comes the rest of MVP, clears up Ninja Boogie with the dust out, they catch the Invis Heroes, and Rappy on the run out, the Broodmother with the cooldown, back on the top of their heads, but look at that, Sanity's Eclipse from MP's OD, triple kill, maybe looking for the Ultra, because QO cannot TP through. Dubu, can you catch the Rior Invoker? It doesn't look like you can, he's going to TP himself back to safety, while over towards the east, it will be an Ultra kill here for MP's OD, kills off four. As they only lose two, but where was your PL? He didn't even TP across.
That's Kyo. Last game, he's on a Spectre. gets into every single fight, not even just through Haunt. Like, he's always in the right place at the right time, going drums, Yosh, move around the map. And then this time, it's just like, oh, you guys got that. It's fine. I'm going to go push mid out. I need more gold.
Well, yeah, I didn't check where his BOT is on cooldown. Was he just deciding?
So.
He didn't need to go. He did not need to go and join the fight. Well, Rior can head back into the Yule Scepter. He didn't go for any upgraded boots here. That Yule Scepter is kind of an old school, well, I guess an older build. Not going to call it obsolete or anything like that. It's still definitely very very viable. It's not going to give you the best combo now that Deafening Blast has been nerfed a fair amount, especially against, you know, Doppelganger, Astral. There are good ways out of this for a lot of MVP's heroes. Snowball as well is a pretty good escape. So it's going to be Axe and Ogre, and not the best heroes to really target with it. We'll see what Rior heads on up to, but it's a cooldown over at the top of three here. On top of this ramp is Derp, the Lion, being shredded through by QO. He's on full HP, just going to chase him down for him. Surviving, Sunstrike's not going to land, but the meatball will clear him up, while Jo drops in the back lines. Rappy's trying his hardest to clear up more. He's killed off one. Do they have reveal? They've got the vision, and from the high ground, raining down the pain is MP's OD. These arcane orbs, just so much damage from MVP.
I always forget there's no cooldown Diffusal Blade now. It's actually so absurd. Just like, immediate purge myself and then just go right onto you. And there's just nothing you can do about it. And those charges, it seems like it's gonna be plenty because they do not have an answer right now in these team fights. Now up to 2600 gold on QO. And it's an Exord Invoker this time, so he doesn't have that same element of control or that nice, you know, ability on the high ground to set something up for his team, get that nice call down available. They don't really have anything that gets them that initial jump, so MP just able to choose all these fights through Forev and his axe. All they have is a little spider creeping around.
And that's the issue, right? The spider, the Broodmother's net worth, it kind of inflates your team. You're looking at these items thinking, well, that's a lot of gold on Broodmother, but she doesn't give you the same kind of impact. Let's say if there was 10k net worth on your Gyro. He's sitting at 7,000. Again, Jo is not having the best time on this Gyrocopter. It's kind of weird, though, because he had good farming in the initial stages. It's just he's tried to be so active with the rest of his team, and the fights, if they don't work out, and you're giving all of this gold across to your OD and your Phantom Lancer, the Gyro just falls off massively.
It's been a while since I've actually been impressed with the Gyro, to be honest, in terms of like what the hero provides. I mean, maybe it's just because I'm comparing it to what he used to be when he was like kind of top tier, you know, number one carry, but when you look at Sven and some of the other heroes that are available right now, just in terms of, like, the actual damage, he doesn't really, like, you don't immediately see it. Maybe it's called in and it's flat cannon and it's not quite as evident as jumping on top of you and critting you to death, but that's the kind of stuff that can catch people off guard, right? Like, suddenly one hero's blown up and you can win the fight, but with a Gyro, it's just incremental damage over time. He's not offering any sort of control, really, except for the slow of the cooldown, but that's hard enough to hit when you have any sort of a setup. I'm not feeling what the Gyro's bringing out here. And at the same time, he's up against Axe, which is a pretty good counter up against them. The OD, pretty nice counter up against them. And then the PL, which has kind of switched tables since the rework. It used to be like Gyro versus PL is great, but now it's like PL gets on top of you with a Diffusal Blade and you are just dead without a BKB.
That's some rough stuff. You look at MVP right now. Oh, they've caught a big army of Spiderlings. Did they dust them? They did. They dusted them. They were looking for the Broodmother, but indirectly getting a lot of gold regardless. Oh, Rave. I see QO. They could start things off with a Hex into stun, but QO has the Reaver.
Huge.
He's got 1600 health. I don't think he's going to be killed off too easily with a Doppelganger forward. Derp gets a stun into the correct one, but he's going to forfeit his life regardless. A dunk here from Forev is all they need to seal the deal. And Roshan, do they know?
Boogie?
They know.
No.
They know.
Yeah, that gem up on Dubu.
Easy Roshan for them. Down at bottom, what they got? Jo farming, pushing, trying to create a little bit of pressure here, but he's going to have to TP out soon. He will retreat back to base, knowing that any one of these heroes from MVP could just run across, cancel out his TP, and maybe kill him off. Sunstrike scouts out this Aegis take. There's not going to be any contest here from Rave. His MVP are just so quick with a Roshan.
Just again, like QO, completely unkillable. 5-0-6.
He's not having fun, though.
No fun. I mean, can you blame him? There's a brood. It's never fun. I always feel like I get kind of stressed out when I play against a brood. I feel like I'm like an ulcer. It's like against a good natured Prophet player. Just, I can't stand it, man. They're just all over the map. I see them peeking up on my mini map. I feel like I gotta deal with you.
It's a constant feeling of leave me alone, leave me alone, leave me, please leave me alone.
Just and, like, leave my lanes alone, leave my jungle alone. Creepy spider.
Just leave everything alone. SNY finally done for the gyro. Another 1,000 gold in the bank. BKB needs that relatively soon, but take a look at what the Invoker's buying. That's a veil. Veil for Invoker.
That's, I mean, it's that situation, right? It's going to be a nice little high ground defense. Going to be helping out Jo quite a bit there. But it's the desperation items.
That's the thing. If there's any item that's going to give you that swing, that little advantage in a team fight to maybe try and bring yourselves back into this game, it's going to be the amplification of the magic damage. Your entire team is magical damage pretty much, yeah. But then you've got a heart fully completed on this Phantom Lancer. What, 2k? 2200 health. Tusk, 1100. Axe, 1200. And he's got 2000 gold in the bank, so he's going to be heading into another big item soon. And they've got the Blink forward with the call out to Rio. He tried to go into the Ghost Walk, but he wasn't fast enough. And with a final dunk from Forev. Oh, you poor little Invoker.
Like, how do you kill him now that he's finished up that heart? Honestly. Alright, Ninja Booty. Oh, I said good day, sir, indeed.
3,000 gold for Forev now. He's picked up an Ogre Club.
I love Axe.
Do you?
Yeah, what a hero. He's so fun to watch. This is like how I found about Invoker before he became overpowered. Fun to watch. Now I just, you know, kind of hate him still. Sorry, Durka. I know you're still one of those Invoker fans.
Yeah. I'm not... This is a thing. There's a difference between an Invoker spammer and an Invoker fan and an Invoker player, right? I'm an Invoker player.
Keep telling yourself that.
Damn it. Nahas is an Invoker fan. The people who just, you know, spam Spectre and Invoker and stuff in ranked games just because, you know, they've figured out that one, like, niche, that one algorithm, whatever, for item builds and skill builds to win their lane and win the game. They are Invoker spammers or Spectre spammers. I'm an Invoker player, and I will keep telling myself that. I'll keep repeating it, and I'm not going to let anyone else tell me otherwise. Damn you!
My Invokers only know how to use Cold Snap and Forward Spirits. What's
that?
My team just loses. I'm just like, God damn it!
Tragic stuff. I still remember a time when I didn't use Ice Wall. Like, Ice Wall was a spell that didn't exist to me like 2 years ago. It was just like, oh yeah, that's a thing. And now it's one of my favorite spells, honestly. Ice Wall is the shit. It's the best.
Oh, we'll see if Rior can make good use of it here, because he needs everything in the bag.
I've already used their veil. He's gonna try and throw the meter. The call, he grabs him. Rior trapped. The damage output's good enough as well, but the dunk not quite there. The Yule Scepter will save him up for a little bit here with the Deafening Blast back with a meatball. QO dropping low, and they got him with the Finger of Death. Finally kills him off, but it's the back end as we're watching one die. OD clears up three. Derp gonna be the fourth here with an ultra kill again for MP's OD. 11-2-5, and the Rack's gonna there we go, straight up with it. GG's called, and Rave tap out.
Alright, well, again, it's certainly I don't want to say a dominating performance. It was a winning performance, but they were always kind of in control. I never really felt like Rave were going to be snagging away the game. There was maybe a little bit with the Broodmother, right? Did pretty well in the bottom lane, got early control of the jungle. But the way MVP counterplayed it, just the fact that they grouped up as five, they moved around the map, and despite not initially laning for up against the Broodmother, you still saw the work that Axe could put in. You can just shove him down there to help stop that push every once in a while, try and keep her away from the rack. She never really got that opportunity. And then committing into the Orchid build, it seems like they had to take some sort of fights because you couldn't apply that same pressure with it, like a Necrobook or something like that. And once again, it just seemed like Rave couldn't initiate the fights they wanted to. They didn't have this big, like, AoE initiator. They didn't have anything that actually forced MVP Phoenix to commit. And so every single fight seemed to be on their terms.
Well, it was difficult stuff all around for Rave, but they do drop down to the lower bracket now. As MVP move themselves forward to the upper bracket semi-final, and they'll be playing against the winner of TNC against Team Towering. We'll find out exactly how that goes down in a couple of days' time, but for now, that's it for the Epicenter qualifiers. We'll be back a little bit later on this channel. I think there's going to be someone else covering. I don't think Cap is doing it. 4 p.m. CET is going to be the European qualifiers. We'll see exactly how that pans out. But we'll be back in 3 hours for WePlay on Join Dota Red. Fnatic against Execration doubleheader coming up at 2 p.m. CET, 9 p.m. Singapore time. So make sure you guys tune in for that one. Myself and Motpax will be back in a few hours. So enjoy your dinner, enjoy your lunch, have a good little break, and we'll see you soon.
Woo!
Yay!